Yes, you know, people in the pledge of allegiance, come on, please, the pledge of allegiance, come on.
To the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Ms. McDonald, would you please report in front? That is great. Dear God, for all that you've done and afforded us and the privileges you've allowed us to share with you, we humbly ask that as we gather in this chamber tonight, that you might touch and sensitize us to your will and to your way. I understand that there's conversations to be had, there are awards to be presented. Please know that it's not us, but it's you. Touch our communities, touch the city of ours, and allow us to sense and to feel your presence in it. We ask it purely.
Amen.
Amen. City manager, move to adopt the agenda, moving out of number 45.
Thank you.
It's a pleasure to recognize the incredible work done by our community planners, American Plan Association, and its professionals to the American Institute of Certified Planners, endorsing National Community Planning Month as an opportunity to highlight the contribution of sound design planning and planning implementation to make quality of life in our communities better. The celebration of National Community Planning Month was an opportunity to publicly recognize the participation and dedication of members of our planning commission and other citizen planners who contributed their time and expertise to the improvement of the city of Columbia. We all know that there are different decisions we make every single day, but there are very few that impact us for prosperity 100 years from now, the way that our streets are laid out, the way that we interact with each other in the public space, are impacted by professional planners and community planners every day. So it is a pleasure to designate October 2018 as Community Planning Month in the City of Columbia and recognize it in conjunction with National Community Planning Month. I said, Ms. Hammond, are you going to receive this? No? I would say it was a good pause.
Two, three.
As always, I'd like to thank
Sister Carrie would like to thank the City of Columbia for giving us so much support. It's very important she and our state and our city experience here in the West.
So, Mr. Mayor, if you would, and the City Council, if y'all join us, and we'll present these proclamations to Sister Carrie and Scarbasso. And I'm not going to read all of them except for to say that we know that October is Mental Health Awareness Month, and so the entire City of Columbia is proclaiming October 2018, excuse me, as Mental Health Awareness Month.
Second. Moved by the second.
discussion? See none, let me read your question. Clerk, please call the roll.
Mr. Rickman.
Aye.
Mr. McDowell.
Yes.
Mr. Devine.
Aye.
Mr. Dubois.
Aye.
Mr. Davis.
Thank you, Mr. Rickman. Thank you so much for your.
Mayor Bending.
Can we take that?
Thank you.
All right. Now, and I'll say this again, I know we've had a chance to talk about Joy's contribution, but I would say I'm amazed every time I get out, I meet more and more people that she touched. I mean, she was building, she built a community, and she built global leaders, I mean, people all across the world who continue to give back to the communities that they live in, including this community. It's just amazing. So I'm not sure how we're gonna do this pitch, but we're gonna give it a try. I'm sure this is gonna excite you. I'm gonna put some lines right here. Anyone who wants to take a picture, all friends and family and double dutches and everyone else, let's come right here and take this picture and recognize you, please.
Joe. Pretty good, how are you?
Yeah, thank you for the kind article.
Oh, I'm glad, I'm really glad you liked it.
Yeah.
So hope I didn't call me or that.
So it's good.
Yeah, Sherry and I have been in contact. She said, and she mentioned it when I was talking to her.
Oh, good.
So trying to line something up with her about doing the Olympia Museum.
That's great.
So,
yeah, that's good.
But I'm really glad.
Yeah,
so.
Good. Sounds good?
I think so. See how we can get this picture taken.
Yeah, right.
Oh, Lord.
And
fortunate and second manager of this committee, and we recognize the contribution of that family to the entirety of Columbia for so many years. It was important. And so thank you for the drive. See somebody pepper in here. Encourage her to come up here for a photograph. So here, please. If your last name is McBride or was McBride, you get what you can hear.
I know that all
almost every member of the McBride family has served in public office. We will not take offense if y'all only hang out here for the rest of this meeting, okay? If y'all slip out, then we're good. We're good. I promise. I promise.
I think I might have, but everybody's tuned out. I'm going to pass it over. We've done it in 10 years. It's not terrible. We are actually going, finishing this year up and with the same partners we had last year, which is always a blessing. Didn't lose anything along the way. Over on the campus, Veterans Hire. I'm a substantial number of hires at Family Shelter. I've started working with St. Lawrence Place. Helping place the families there, so we've sort of expanded a little bit. This past summer, we actually developed three technology-based camps for adventure based on the exhibits in the museum, so that children can have an extra experience and put a little lab over there. We're looking at hoping to expand that some summer, and adding a summer camp for the children at St. Lawrence Place and Family Shelter, and a program this December, while kids are out of school at Family Shelter in St. Lawrence Place. We're going over there 4 nights a month to work with job skills and technology-based training to help them get ready to go to work. So we've kept our special needs programs going and managed to hold on to everything else. So next year's a big one. We'll be 20. I can't imagine it, but you know, we're the only ones left, Mr. Davis, at the very beginning. Even Mr. Vine came after us, so I'm saying it's kind of hard. But I do have a couple things for everybody. I'm excited that we're still able to serve the residents of this area and hope to continue doing so. And we thank you, our original partner, and how we all got started with planning for the technology piece of the empowerment center, and somehow or another, all these years later, we're still building on it. So thank you for your support. And tell me
what
you thought
we
could
pass out.
Just
asking. Oh, yeah. Yeah, I'm coming up here for later. What would you like me to do?
I'll put that for later.
We'll
get
it. Yeah, we will. All right, I'll leave it. Right. Oh, I'll just for everybody.
Yes, ma'am.
We'll let the head of logistics be the
one that has the chance to answer the questions. We've been bad behavior. Any questions? I apologize.
Questions? Congratulations.
Huge deal. We got to spend more time making sure that our relationship is not only long, but much deeper than it has been the last several years. Look forward to having that discussion.
I would very much like to have that conversation because we see the continuing need for helping our government uses those we have to address them.
You guys are thoughtful and creative and also flexible with the changing needs of those 2 day meetings.
The benefit of doing it through technology.
Amen. Amen. Thank you.
Thank you.
We have technology deployed within our sewer collection system that to monitor levels within our critical manholes, whether it's to an area of concern, we get an alarm, a text message on our phone, we can pull up an iPad and track, send that data. That allows our system operators to stay safe, stay inside during the storm event, and only deploy if there's something wrong. We don't have to physically be out there looking. We can use the data from that feedback. Also, I want to point out advances that we've made in mapping. We have dashboard tools now that integrate our CityWorks work order system, how we manage our work, what our crews are doing in the field. They're using iPads. They're actually out in the field working work orders, and it's real-time updating our database. We're doing that on the wastewater collection side, and something that we're moving to in other areas of our operations, such as water distribution. It's been very successful for us. But the fact that we've got good integrity of that data allows us to manipulate that data and make management decisions and look at key performance indicators. We're using a dashboard tool for that as well. I mentioned that we're leveraging some of these advancements that we've been able to make in the wastewater utility over to the drinking water utility side. We're really excited about that because we think that's going to improve our response time and improve our customer service, as it has on the wastewater side. In terms of compliance with our consent decree, we're on target, we're on schedule, we're meeting every deliverable, either by the deadline or in advance of the deadline. We have a very key deliverable that is coming up very, very soon. I'd say it's due in November 2019, but we're working hard on that. It's called the Infrastructure Rehabilitation Report, and that's our major sewer assets, our major pipelines are being evaluated, and we're going to commit to making improvements that are necessary to again minimize sanitary sewer overflows and the issues we might have. Those will become enforceable deadlines within our consent decree, so we start seeing quite a few large construction projects coming out and opening for the public and coming before you as council to approve in the coming months and years. We can show a map of just the areas that we're working, and right now we're working throughout the collection system a few projects that are worth pointing out. There's a major sewer improvement project that is going to be bidding relatively soon in Lake Catherine area. That will help us minimize sanitary sewer overflows in that area. Rocky Ranch is another key area that's under design right now. We're going to be bidding in the not too distant future. We've got improvements in the Crane Creek Basin, projects going on the Metro Wastewater Plant, and also these sanitary sewer evaluation projects that are happening throughout our collection system, where we're going through and evaluating our system, determining what rehabilitation needs to happen, even in the smaller parts within the system. So a lot of work going throughout the collection system right now. And we're seeing fruits of that work and that investment that we're making. We've seen significant reductions in our sanitary sewer overflow numbers, and I wanted to share those with you and show the public graphically what we're looking at. You remember in 2015, everybody remembers the flooding of Hurricane Joaquin that we had. We also had a significant volume of sanitary sewer overflows in county in 2015. Moving on to 16, there was a 57% reduction, but still a very high volume, 2.3 million gallons of wastewater spilled onto the ground and into sinking streams. Some of that was attributed to Hurricane Matthew season, but also in March of 2017, we completed several key projects that tightened up our system and gave us additional capacity. So if you look at calendar year 2017, we dropped to about 675,000 gallons of wastewater spill. A great reduction, still not an acceptable number, but a great reduction, 71% reduction over calendar year 16. And then if we look at calendar year to date, we're at less than 95,000 gallons of wastewater spill. If you look at that compared to where we were in 2014 or 15, just a tremendous success that the investments that you have approved for us to make, we're seeing significant reductions. Now, we haven't had as wet a season, and that certainly contributes to it, but a lot of the infrastructure improvements are in place that are needed to minimize the sanitary sewer overflows. Why that's so important is the volume of wastewater that we're not collecting and treating, that to potential public health hazard, that's a potential environmental hazard. So the more we can minimize that, the better results will be, the better we're serving our community and our customers. I'll move on and just talk quickly about the road ahead. We have a lot of success, and we're very proud of where we are. There's much work to do moving forward. We're by no means finished yet, but we feel like we're on a good pace, on a good path to fulfill our requirements within the consent decree. We've changed the way we operate. What's ahead of us are heavy capital projects that will be coming. And so many of those are being designed now. Some of the system is still being evaluated. Those projects will show up in that infrastructure rehabilitation. So we're kind of at a key juncture right now, figuring out exactly what the finish line is going to look like in the next 8 to 10 years. But we feel like we're in a really good position right now, in a good place with compliance with our consent decree, and how we're operating and maintaining all these water collection systems. So I'll field any questions that you might have.
Incredible progress. Let's see, continue to build on the road. And honestly, as I know Ms. Davis here with you earlier, I think as much as we can do, continue to ensure this is our local business participation and as incredible investment as possible. It's good to see the ideas and the planning, and all that we theoretically to have genetic impacts, improvements on quality of life for our communities. You guys are doing a great job. So that's it. Mr. Duval.
Clint, seeing the presentation again and realizing how much you put into the GIS and show the maps of what we're doing, as you drill out and get the construction system on there, Chief Overbrook sends us a weekly report on code enforcement from his division, and he breaks it down about council vision, which I think would be a great graph for four people, more than two people, to show us that maybe you can even add stormwater on that by district, so that they would have that information as they go to their individual.
Yes, sir. That's an excellent idea. We can give y'all each a quick snapshot of the help and work out to those who are in school stormwater infrastructure.
I think it would be great.
Thank you. Thank y'all for the support. Appreciate that from my council and certainly Joey and his staff for a phenomenal job. And all the city departments are really supporting the great work that's being done. So thank you very much.
We know that the City of Columbia currently annexes parcels of property of upon which there's storm drainage facilities on the easement to Richland County. The county obtained those easements by contract or consideration of private property owners. And so it's necessary just to have this civil action in order just to get a declaratory judgment from the court to determine which entity is responsible for the maintenance of stormwater lines on private property. I do want to make sure that the people within the Salmon Forest realize that we're willing to and looking forward to working with the county to meet the needs of our citizens in so many areas that are affected with these legacy issues. In particular, working aggressively to meet the needs of the Belvedere community, and Mr. McDowell has aggressively worked to try and address when meeting these by citizens. This is a way in which we can get some type of statutory clarity to these issues, and once we do, we'll be able to move forward, and hopefully we'll be able to move forward together with the county, which means financial participation from the city and the county. But we need this this clarity. I'll move the previous question.
Mr. Rickman?
Aye.
Mr. McDowell?
Yes.
Mr. Hall?
Aye.
Mr. Vaughn?
Aye.
Mr. Davis?
Aye.
Apologies, I did omit a mental illness awareness.
We put it right in there.
My apologies.
The ladies have been sitting right here in front of me the entire time. I have my glasses on the day here. It's an honor to take some time to recognize Mental Illness Awareness Week. Columbia and the entire nation have resolved to proclaim October 7th and 13th as Mental Illness Awareness Week. And you know, it's really improper to recognize this issue officially to encourage advocacy for a compassionate community and our citizens. It's appropriate to help honor individuals and families who are impacted by mental illness and working to build a stronger community. We know that approximately 1 in 5 youth aged 13 to 18 experiences severe mental disorder at some point during their life. Whereas 1 in 5 adults in the U.S., which equates to over almost 44 million people, or 18.5% of our population, experiences mental illness in a given year, and 1 in 25 adults in the U.S. experiences a serious mental illness in a given year that substantially interferes with or limits one or more major life activity. We recognize the importance of amplifying the awareness of mental illness so that residents locally and abroad may understand the importance of good mental health and be aware of the resources available to them. So it's an honor on behalf of our city to recognize our role in the continuum of care and recognize this as Mental Illness Awareness Week, the week of October 7th to October 13th. Can you say something?
Mid Carolina and the people we serve in the Midlands, I'd like to say thank you for recognizing Mental Illness Awareness Month and recognizing that by being one in five being impacted by mental illness, it pretty much impacts us all.
Come back to us at an appropriate time. You don't have the ability to
strike the bond, right? All right?
Mr. Rivera.
Aye.
Mr. Powell.
Aye.
Mr. Brown.
Aye.
Mr. Rivera.